From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Neurology Author Interviews. Conversations with authors exploring the latest clinical research, reviews, and opinions featured in JAMA Neurology.
My name is Dr. Cynthia Armand, Associate Professor of Neurology at the Albert Einstein College of Medicine, Montefiore Medical Center, and JAMA Neurology Web Editor. Today's topic is prevention of vasospasm after aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage. Joining me today is Dr. Peter Vajkoczy. He is discussing the work of he and his colleagues entitled Localized Nicardipine Release Implants for Prevention of Vasospasm After Aneurysmal Subarachnoid Hemorrhage, a Randomized Clinical Trial. Dr. Vajkoczy is a professor and chairman of the Department of Neurosurgery at Charité Berlin Institution in Berlin, Germany. Dr. Vajkoczy, welcome to the podcast.
Dr. Armand, thank you so much for having me and thank you for so much interest in our work. And it's a pleasure to join you for this talk. Happy to be here.
Excellent. So, Dr. Vajkoczy, tell our listeners about aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage and further reasons for neurologic injury that can occur in an encounter after aneurysmal repair. And I'd love to hear your perspective as a neurosurgeon.
So Dr. Armand, yeah, it's a pleasure because that is really coming from my heart, the topic of aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage or SAH, as we like to make it a little bit briefer. So the reason for these bleedings or hemorrhagic strokes in the end is a rupture of a cerebral aneurysm. The incidence is 7 out of 100,000. And the consequence is that you have a hemorrhage to the surface of the brain, sometimes even into the brain. And the primary injury is from the increase in ICP and intracranial pressure due to the rupture and the hemorrhage. Mm-hmm. And then we have a list of secondary injuries. And one of those is vasospasm. The blood vessels react to the blood around it in the subarachnoid space and they constrict, and this might cause stroke. But besides of that, there are other reasons for secondary injuries like hydrocephalus, like the consequences of the treatment because the aneurysm has to be obliterated mm-hmm. either by endovascular means or by surgical means or by any other intensive care complication that might occur.
Mm-hmm. And in your experience with what's been seen with complications, for example, delayed cerebral ischemia from vasospasm, what are risk factors for that? Are there predisposed risk factors in the individual itself?
So that's a very good question because this would help to identify patients that are at risk and perform an individualized treatment. But so far, it's quite difficult to really understand risk factors. Number one risk factor is the amount of blood that has been spilled into the subarachnoid space mm-hmm. following the rupture of the aneurysm. Then it's usually in younger patients where you obviously have less calcified blood vessel walls and there's a predominance of female patients. But in the end, it's really the amount of blood and the severity of the hemorrhage. So if we go to classify patients with aneurysmal subarachnoid hemorrhage, mm-hmm. it's usually from 1 to 5, according to the Hunt and Hess scale. And those with a more severe hemorrhage that are doing worse, they have a higher risk, which correlates in the end with the amount of blood.
Mm-hmm. Now, when we encounter patients like this, as a neurologist coming into the emergency room and given recommendations and obviously calling neurosurgery, what is standard of care that you would want to tell our listeners? Okay, before you call neurosurgery, obviously we're calling neurosurgery, but before you do that, this is what you should do, X, Y, and Z, especially for maybe emergency room physicians before they even get to neurology.
Right. So patients might either present awake or comatose. Mm-hmm. And if they are awake, they might complain of a severe headache or meningeal signs, rigidity in their neck. If they're comatose, then there might have been an episode of headache and then secondary loss of consciousness. So the first thing obviously you would do is performing a CT following the clinical examination. And the CT will reveal in most cases the blood. if you still have a suspicion, but there is no blood on CT, that then you might continue with a lumbar puncture. And obviously the CT is important to rule out any other reasons for a headache, like a mass or space occupying lesion where you would not perform the lumbar puncture. So with these two maneuvers, you would get to the diagnosis of SAH, subarachnoid hemorrhage, and then you might call the neurosurgeon for a further consult.
Right. Now, with approaching cerebral vasospasm, leading into your study here, what's the usual standard approach for therapy?
So the patients that we are looking at are patients whose aneurysm has been occluded either by endovascular or by surgical means. And then they are usually on the ICU. And then there, the patients, again, can come into situations. Either they are awake, then they can be assessed neurologically, or they are not awake. Then they have to be monitored for vasospasm, the constriction of the basal blood vessels, like the internal carotid artery or the middle cerebral artery, using transcranial Doppler sonography. And if the awake patients become neurologically symptomatic, they might develop a hemiparesis or might develop sluggish speech, or they have an increase in the velocity and the transcranial Doppler sonography. These are all indications for vasospasm. In the end, vasospasm means that the blood vessels get constricted. You have a reduced perfusion pressure, less blood is reaching the brain, and these patients are at high risk of developing secondary strokes, secondary ischemia, which then might affect their outcome and turn the outcome more adverse than they had initially been.
Now, as when I was training, I was used to, okay, you start the nicardipine drip right away, and we get things rolling in terms of helping the patient with improvements of that vasospasm. In your study, you talk about localized nicardipine release implants. I'm very fascinated by this. How did this come about? What's the inspiration for your study? And can you tell us about these implants?
So the problem is the following. In order to prevent or to overcome the constriction of a blood vessel, you would like to apply a vasodilatory substance. And the straightforward approach in the past has been to use calcium antagonists or calcium receptor blockers, which are nimodipine or nicardipine. Nimodipine is more in the US or in Europe, and nicardipine is more in Japan. There are slight differences, but not going into much into detail. The problem is that these drugs have to be administered in a high concentration in order to have the concentration of the dose that you need in order to dilate the blood vessels, which will result in side effects like cardiac side effects, hypotension, things like that. So these are contradictory, or they are not really helping the patients, since a drop in blood pressure is the opposite of what you would like to have. So the idea was to really deliver the drugs directly to the brain or to the blood vessels where they should be active, and to avoid systemic side effects by avoiding a systemic delivery. And the idea was to create local implants that you could place around the blood vessels, and then they would release the vasoactive drug, and this would result in a high concentration at the site where they should work.
So tell us about how you devised your study.
This study is the end of a relatively long journey. The development of these implants, which are releasing nicardipine. This is a phase 2B trial that has followed a phase 2A trial where we have tested for toxicity and where that was a dose-finding study. The one that we are talking about now is the phase 2B trial, which was a randomized, small-volume, multicenter trial where we have included 41 patients. In the end, 39 patients could be evaluated. And patients were randomized to two groups, the ones that in a blinded way, for those that are on the ICU, only the surgeon knew what the patients had received, either these implants or no implants. And five centers were included in Germany and in Austria. And then these patients were followed. And the primary outcomes of the study was development of vasospasm, development of delayed cerebral ischemia, and secondary outcomes were outcome and how long the patients had to stay in the hospital and what the therapy intensity level for these patients was.
Yeah, let's go right into the results. Tell us what you found.
Oh, we were very excited to find that this strategy was very efficient in reducing cerebral vasospasm following microsurgical clipping. So this is a pilot study where we have occluded the aneurysms by clipping using the craniotomy. So the vessels were exposed during surgery, and then these implants were directly placed to the blood vessels. Obviously, not every patient is treated by microsurgery, but this is proof of concept that these implants work. Could be also used for those that are treated by endovascular means in the future. In the end, we could show that there was a significant reduction in angiographic and morphological vasospasm, so the amount of blood vessels that were constricted, and the extent how they were constricted was significantly reduced from 60% to 20%, which was significant. Mm-hmm. And that also meant that these patients had to be treated less by additional means to overcome vasospasm. What you would do is increase blood pressure or perform an angioplasty with an endovascular strategy or do any maneuver in order to overcome this vasospasm or this vasoconstriction.
Oh, that's very significant, especially in terms of your primary endpoints. How about your secondary endpoints?
So secondary endpoints, we had good trends. So we could show that there was also a strong trend in reduced secondary ischemia. That is of relevance because it shows that the treatment or the prevention of vasospasm and vasoconstriction obviously could also prevent secondary strokes. Furthermore, we could show that the length of stay on the ICU was significantly reduced, which reflects that these patients had a better clinical course, but also shows that you can reduce costs by this kind of treatment. And there was a very mild trend for a difference in clinical outcome after 1 year, but the study was not powered for clinical outcome. And this is something that has to be addressed in the future.
Mm-hmm. So these are incredible results. And I think the innovation of this, especially where medicine is heading into the future, is quite remarkable and remarkable for the types of patients we take care of, especially in aneurysm, subarachnoid hemorrhage. I mean, it's very scary. I practice headache medicine, and that is the number one question of any patient with headache, especially if they have a family history of aneurysm or even if they don't. So I think this is pretty remarkable in terms of how we can help with sequelae of disease when we're dealing with these types of clinical entities. What is next for you and your colleagues in terms of this research?
So we are very excited because we are working on vasospasm or in the vasospasm field for the last 30 years. And as you really say, I hear you, Dr. Armand, it's really sometimes frustrating. You treat the aneurysm and then patients are dying of secondary strokes and vasospasm. So what's next? Next will be really, we have to show that these results also turn in an improved outcome for our patients. That means we have to perform another study, a phase 3 trial, more patients, more centers, and we have to really show that improvement of vasospasm is really beneficial in terms of patient outcome and reducing costs and making the life of the physician treating these patients easier. The next step after that, obviously, has to be that we also have to open the indication for those patients that are not treated by clipping, by microsurgery, but also undergoing endovascular procedures. So we are currently working on ways how to deliver these implants for those that are not receiving a craniotomy by minimally invasive means, by MIS. And these are the two next steps that are really important, and we are really looking forward to putting these things further and seeing some progress in this field.
I'm certainly looking forward to this, as I know our listeners and readers are. Dr. Vasospasm, thank you so much for joining us today for the podcast.
Dr. Armand, it was really a pleasure, and I thank you and the journal for the attention and for having me here and giving me us or our team the opportunity to really talk about the results in your podcast. And last but not least, I would really take the opportunity and thank all these collaborators and the sponsor that made that study possible. And just to name the centers, we are very grateful to the centers in Austria, in Vienna, in Innsbruck, and in Graz, and in Linz, and also in Germany, in Göttingen, and in Munich. And they have done a wonderful job by recruiting these patients and staying with us. And our independent and blinded neuroradiology department in Heidelberg, I also would like to acknowledge their excellent work. So thank you so much to the whole team. Done an excellent job.
This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. This is Dr. Cynthia Armand. Thank you for listening.